Hey, 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 Fit Mama. Jen Oliver here, your host of the Fit Mama podcast. This is the work in to your workout. Hey, Fit Mama, and welcome to episode 32. I am so excited to be here today with none other than my good friend and fellow coach from the Mom Is In Control podcast, Heather Chauvin. Heather Chauvin is a longtime friend of mine, and she is a true inspiration to me and so many. She has an incredible TEDx talk that she did, that we did together at TEDx Windsor. I'm so proud of her. Her talk was amazing, and it is called Dying to Be a Good Mother. So check it out. It is so interesting. She is so interesting. She's a beautiful, humble, kind, nurturing, loving soul that I am so grateful to know. You will absolutely fall in love with her too. Be inspired by her message of self-care, self-love. We go into energetic time management. We go into her fitness routine and her beliefs around self-care and self-love. And she dives into her own very personal story, in addition to her education and her own children, as to how she came to the conclusions that she did. And she is writing her first book right now, which I know I cannot wait to read when it comes out. And without further ado, I introduce you to Heather Chauvin.
Here we are. We're live with Heather Chauvin from heatherchauvin.com and the Mom Is In Control podcast. So I am so excited today to talk to you, Heather, wise one. And you have so much wisdom to share on so many levels. But I love that you talk so much about self-care, that you talk so much about taking time for yourself, doing things for yourself, putting yourself first, all that good stuff. So today we're talking about taking care of yourself, but maybe let's preface taking care of yourself by you telling us how you got here and how are you now, what you're doing and who you are. Please share. Thank you for being here.
Oh boy, that's a loaded question. Thanks, Jen. I love, I don't even know how long we've known each other for, but we live in the same town. Yeah, we live in the same town. We've kind of watched each other go through this wild, crazy journey. And I think it all starts with desire to have more. And I don't mean have more money, have a bigger house, even though those are some of the desires, but it's to feel full as a woman and as a mother. And I think that's really, really important. And so part of my story, part of my story is I just felt empty in my life for a very, very long time. And the scary thing about that was I was checking the boxes. I was late to this call because I just got off the phone with a woman who was like, Heather, on the outside, everything looks great. I have the job. I've succeeded in my job. Job pays well. I'm married. I have two children. And yet there's something missing. So culturally, we don't advocate for this. And so for a very long time in my life, I felt crazy for asking the question of, is anyone else struggling or is it just me? And so when I looked in, not when I looked inside, but when I actually was seeking help, going to the doctor, going to a therapist, the feedback I was receiving was, you're fine. This is normal. Here's some antidepressants and good luck. Part of my story too, is I have a background in mental health and social work. And I don't know what's going on here. The like lighting just changed all of a sudden, but anyways, background in social work. And what happened was my son, so I have three boys, they're 12, 7, and 4. And when my 12-year-old was around 4 and he started school, I noticed this huge shift in his behavior and he became very angry and anxious. And so I found meditation for him because I thought, okay, I'm educated in mental health and nobody will help me. Like, oh, it's just a phase, Heather, get over it. Oh, just read this book, just do this strategy. And I was reading the books, I was doing the strategies, and yet I could not figure out what was going on. And that part of me that said, he'll get over this, was saying, no, he won't. You are here to teach him, Heather. what he needs to do. Mm-hmm. And so that's when I found meditation and mindfulness, and then had, you know, after I got certified in it and started teaching him and using those tools, realizing that mindfulness was something that we could both learn. It wasn't just him who needed to learn mindfulness. It was me as well.
Yes. So let's backtrack for one sec, because I think that's a really, really, really important point and something that at Fit Mama we're always talking about. And, you know, whether you've done my ebook program or whether you're just following day by day or you've done the foundations program, we are always talking about specific things. And I think it's really pertinent to talk about here this idea of mindfulness. Mm-hmm. I teach this idea of being really present and noticing things around you and not just being dictated by your thoughts or habits that you're having. But what is that? Like, what does that really look like? And why is that in contrast with mental health and all the stuff that you were exposed to? Give me a bit of a context for that in your expertise.
So mindfulness to me, and it could mean different things to many people or depending on the definition or modality that you're observing, is just being aware of the positive and negative that's going on within you and observing the systems or strategies, observing the connections. So example, super example, not so much now, and I don't know why, maybe because I'm taking better care of my body or it's healing from cancer, and that's a whole nother story that I could tell. Before, when I would drink coffee, I would notice anxiety in myself. There was a correlation between coffee and anxiety. There was a correlation between eating popcorn at night and anxiety in the morning. I would only know this because I was observing my body of having these little challenges or experiments, as one of my clients would say, these little science experiments of just being mindful, aware, self-awareness. That's all it is. So I would also do this with my kids and observe, how are they at night when they go to bed at 8, when they go to bed at 8:30, when they go to bed at 9? Why am I so angry? Why am I angry right now? Why am I angry when my child says, shut up? But if my child says, go away, you mean mother, I'm not triggered. What is it about the word shut up that triggers me? What is it about certain noises that trigger me? So it's about awareness and mindfulness. And I think in this industry, people go, oh, that doesn't feel good. I want to run away from it. To me, mindfulness is also running towards it. So if I'm scared of something, I'm going to look at it and I'm going to go, interesting. Why am I so afraid to do this? How does this move through my body? Where does this show up? And then the next time I'm in the same situation or a similar situation, and I go, oh yeah, every time I get afraid, I have this like big ball of energy right here. Mm-hmm. Okay, I must just be afraid. So it's about having the body awareness, the mental awareness to understand when I take this action, this is what happens. And so, I mean, it's a loaded question, but that's what it means to me.
A quick interruption from today's episode to share with you one of our show sponsors, Best Self Journal. I don't know about you, but I am a bit of a journal junkie. I love goal setting and planning and executing in a way that makes goal getting fun. It wasn't until I was gifted this Best Self Journal by a coach I was working with that I fell in love with it and now give it to all the fit mamas I begin working privately with. The ease of using this journal and the laying out of the priorities that are needed to move forward on tasks and epic happenings in your life is so simple and fun with this journal. Have you discovered the Best Self Journal yet? I guarantee that using this journal will move you towards feeling your best. And I just ordered the Smart Marks bookmark and the weekly planner pad, which I am so excited for, and I will share how much I am loving those in the future. Productivity, organization, and focus are keys for fitting in all the things that you want, making sure that you are achieving the things you set out for yourself. I'm sure you know how good that feels to be organized, planned, and ready to execute. Click the link below and get your own Best Self Journal today.
Yeah. Okay. And when it comes to labeling those those emotions, I guess, when it comes to physical, because I mean, same thing. We always are teaching about listening to your body, right? And that is the same thing you talk about a lot, right? It's if you want to be in control and if you want to be mindful and there present through day-to-day things before you jump into yelling at your kids or just feeling frayed or overwhelmed, you are taking time to breathe. You're taking time to be there. And you are facing the fears, as you said. So what does it take to face the fears? Because most of us don't want to, right? And taking care of yourself is hard. And when we have other things and we have other people to take care of, we easily go on the back burner. And you've seen and experienced this firsthand, the breakdowns that it can lead to, and also the light, right? The light at the end of the tunnel. So tell us a little bit about your journey, Heather, in that way.
Yeah. So, okay. First of all, I get this feedback all the time. People go, oh, mom is in control. Oh, ha, ha, ha. I'm so out of control. Or yeah, I'm so controlling. The essence of being in control in your life is feeling in control even when shit hits the fan. Like knowing that, yeah, I've been pushing myself too far this week, or today's just been a go, go, go day from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. You understand how to get back to your ground zero. You know how to understand to get back to that centered place in your being. But what happens is culturally, we just like do more, do more, do more, do more, do more. And you end up over here and you don't even remember a time in your life when you felt peaceful and content. Mm-hmm. I have days when I'm like over here and then I have days when I'm over here. But the great thing is now I've committed myself mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually to not really get that far. If somebody wants me to go all the way over here, I'm not willing to do it. It's just not in my contract anymore. Meaning I won't even work with a client that like makes me drag them along. That's why I, you know, I have conference calls with everybody. I'm like, hey, you're not a right fit, or yes, let's go. We got this. Mm-hmm. Because I'm living more in alignment with what I want in my life. If it doesn't work, it's a simple no. Mm-hmm. So almost four years ago now, I literally go by like the length of my hair. It's so awful. I'm like, I've cut my hair since then, but I just want it longer and longer. Cause it's like, it's just, it's a representation to me of like a barometer of how far I've come. So almost 4 years ago, I had stage 4 cancer. And I believe this was a result of neglecting myself. So I've come to terms with the fact over the years doing research in cancer and disease and all of that, you know, we're all prone to all of these things. And it's whether we allow that gene to turn on or off in our lives. And we can do very many preventative measures, whether it could be something as simple as going to bed and drinking water. And yet culturally, we're not taught to do that. So 4 years ago, where was I? I had 3 boys. My youngest was a year. And after postpartum, I never went back to the same person I was. And my body just didn't either. And I just assumed I was still in post-baby. But my abdomen started growing. And as my abdomen started growing, I used my natural coping strategies and defense mechanisms to convince myself, and I'm going to say this loud, ladies, that I did not have time for myself. I didn't have time to go to the doctor. I didn't have time to eat. I didn't have time to take a shit. I didn't have time to wash my hair. I didn't have time to brush my teeth. Oh gosh, I wore the martyr badge really well. And everybody around me who was like, oh yeah, I went shopping and bought myself a shirt, I looked at them like they were an awful human being for doing anything for themselves. Wow. So I, you know, when people look at me now and go, oh, must be nice, I go, it is really fucking nice because I'm alive. Mm-hmm. And the opposite is to be dead. And I almost died. By the time I was diagnosed, it was a stage 4. I was against Western medicine because, you know, we all are if we drink green smoothies. And so I thought I could just drink green smoothies and meditate my cancer away. And the truth was, it was one of the rarest rapid growing cancers. So I had to surrender to Western medicine. And actually, I was just writing because I'm writing a book. And one of the headlines is going to be like, cancer was my cleanse. It was, sorry, not cancer. Chemo was my cleanse. Okay. And that's an oxymoron, but it gave me my life back. It, you know, my body was in crisis, and that's what that Western medicine is there for. So, but after that, then I'm good, right? Then you're told that you're in remission, Heather. There you go. left at the road with my bald head and, you know, my little body. And I had to figure out how to live. That's truly what I had to do. I didn't know how to put up boundaries. I had no idea what to say no to, what to say yes to. I didn't know how to feel alive. I didn't know how to feel joy. I didn't know how to feel connection. At that point, I was still yelling at my kids. And yeah, I've just stopped. And when I yell now, I truly understand why I'm yelling. And that all goes back to mindfulness. My belief systems have changed. How I structure my day has changed. Who I hang around with has changed. How I structure my business has changed. And I've made triple the money, and I'm working less, and I'm giving way more to my clients and everybody else around me. And it's really magic, and it's not rocket science. It's boundaries and permission.
I love that. That's amazing. So, you talk about this concept all the time on your podcast and in your Facebook group, is this idea of energetic time management. And yeah. I love that. And I love what you teach around this. And you know, yes, as much as we need to learn boundaries, because we aren't taught, especially as women, right? We have to be everything to everybody, and we're here and we got it. We don't need
belief system.
Right? Yeah, right. We have all these belief systems. So tell me a little bit about what that means to you, because you learn this concept through experience. And how does fitness and your physically active lifestyle play a role in this energetic time management? Because you're giving out of energy. And that's one of the things fit mamas are saying. They're saying, I'm exhausted. I don't know if I need a nap or if I need to get to the gym, right? Like they aren't sure what these signals are.
So I have to laugh because I've never taken a nap and woke up and that, like, I was like, oh yes, I'm not tired anymore.
Okay.
Like sometimes I, if you take a nap, it might be like a 10-minute reset. Okay. Like I take naps all the time, but now it's like a little 10-minute reset. Before it was like, I need to take a 4-hour nap and then I'd wake up still feeling tired.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You could sleep for a whole week straight, get rid of your kids. You still will not feel energized.
Yeah.
That's a system failure. There's something deeper going on. So it's not like, I just wish people would stop saying, I have an infant at home and I'm not getting night sleep. And so that's why, like, we need to check the hormone levels, not get more sleep. Yes, you definitely need more sleep, but getting more sleep is not going to change all your problems. Fitness has become my number one priority. Before I had cancer, I just convinced myself that I was not I always compare fitness to being like an athlete. I think there's a big mindset shift there. I'm not an athlete by any means. Never was. I did some gymnastics because I'm flexible, but that was about it. So I started running. I love running now. Mentally, it makes me feel good. I don't care if I need my knees replaced when I'm older. It makes me feel mentally on top of the world. My mental health is more important than, you know, a few knee injuries. And I just say this because people will not, they're like, oh, I can't run because I have bad whatever. And I'm like, have you ever tried running? They're like, no. And I'm like, you're just using that as an excuse. If you legit can't do something, that's one thing. But if you're just too chicken to try, then you just need to stop using your excuse.
I just want to take another quick second here to announce a second show sponsor for today. This sponsor is Muse Brain Sensing Technology. As I am always talking about on the Fit Mama podcast and online, taking the time to quiet your mind, create space and calm is essential to living a loving Fit Mama life. This is achieved through meditation, among other things. One of the tools I've discovered to make this even more of an achievable goal in your life is Muse. Muse is a headband that you wear, and the sensors actually sense your brainwave activity. I know. And then it gives you feedback as to whether you are in the calm zone or if your brain patterns are a bit stormy. Literally, it has storm sounds, then birds when your brain is calm. It's very fun. It's like training your brain by lifting weights or dancing to a routine. This creates the neural pathways to help boost your connection to calm all day, every day, by training and knowing exactly how it feels. I don't think there's anything better. real-time feedback for your brain training. It's worth it. And the data is out there to show it. Meditation improves lives, and it will improve yours. Start today with 15% off all your orders at Muse using the link in the show notes today. And back to our show.
Well, definitely excuses is a thing, but you know what? I'm sure that you can get so much benefit even just from walking, because how much is it just getting outside?
Your body. I mean, exactly. I see this body now as a house. And yes. If I'm walking into my house and it's disgusting, like I haven't cleaned it at all, I haven't tidied a room. Nobody wants to be in that environment. I get this one body, and I almost lost this one body. And so now I just respect her. I respect her so much more, and I'm co-creating with her. She shows me all the time when to stop, when to go, when to say yes, when to say no. And it's a co-creation, and I want to make her look good. I want her to make her feel good, and I want to continue that. So the original question you had was the energetic time management piece. Very inspired by Danielle Laporte's work with the desire map. I don't know why, but when I read the desire map, it's all about and she has her calendar or her, what do you call that? Yeah. Her calendars, like her desire map things. Yeah. Is your soul on your to-do list? Is your soul on your to-do list? You desire to have a healthy body, but is that even on your calendar? Well, no, I don't have time for it. Great. Keep telling yourself that until you've run out of time, until you're dead. So I experimented with myself, and I was like, okay, week one, I'm going to go to the gym one time, or I'm going to go for a walk or whatever this is. So where I'm at now is, I teach people this in my masterminds called Mom Is In Control Mastermind. Do a lot of free stuff inside my Facebook group and podcast. Energetic time management is, are your days set up in alignment with how you want to feel? I know you're a big fan of the passion planner, and so am I. You know, people just like do a to-do list and they're like, check, 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 check. You got to be fulfilled after your to-do list is complete. And if your soul is not on that to-do list, if your deep desires are not on that to-do list, if I want to like travel the world, well, maybe step one is call a travel agent or Google something. I will literally, excuse me, put that action step on my physical calendar. Oh, from 10 to 11 today, I have a whole hour. I'm just going to research something. We're not making time for what we want in our lives. And then we're allowing other people to fill our time. So then when I get that unexpected text message from a friend who wants to do coffee, or somebody, my mom, who just stops by and knocks on my door because I work from home, I go, Mom, I'm like, I got something to do. And, and you just set boundaries. And so when we're setting our time up in alignment with how we want to feel, we're full, but we have to ask ourselves, what do we really want?
And from your experience, why and where does it come from that we don't even give ourselves that space, right? I mean, yes, we're conditioned to it. Like I said, you know, our culturally, it's like, oh yeah, sure. You have all the time in the world. You can do whatever. But when does it stop? Is it when we get overwhelmed? Is it when we start telling ourselves these stories? Or where do we know that it's changed into excuses from reality?
So first of all, I've asked myself this question many times because I have a strong desire to nurture other people. I believe that's part of like DNA. And, you know, some women are like, I have a strong nurturing where I just love, love, love nurturing my children and other people. And then others are like, I have no desire to do that. It's just part of who you are. I could all day, every day coach women from sunrise to sunset and just hang out with my kids and do all those things, but it's not serving me. It's not life enhancing. And the only reason why I know it's not life enhancing is because I've experienced the opposite. So I've experienced the good and I've experienced the bad. So I have to create that balance. And I don't like the word balance, but I like the word alignment. Too much of a good thing is never a good thing. Right. So I think it's generational as well, right? Like in society, women are always the nurturers. But it's okay to be who you are. And I think there's a lot of that coming up too, because I, you know, work with women who are stay-at-home moms, and then I work with women who are like high-level CEOs. And the high-level CEOs, workaholic women, are like, I feel like I'm failing as a parent because I do want to spend more time with my children. I just don't know how to balance both. Mm-hmm. And then the stay-at-home moms say, and I'm generalizing here, not every person says this, I feel like I'm not contributing to society as much. I feel like there's more in me to give, and I don't know what that is, but I want to explore that. So I truly feel like all of us as human beings have a difference, there's parts of us that want to nurture our families on a micro level and then make an impact on a macro level. And I think we have to give ourselves permission to look at both and not just like expect, oh, everyone does this, so that's what I need to do. Because you will get depressed very easy. You will get angry and frustrated. And I always say that your emotion is a behavior, and your behavior is a language. So if you are angry, if you are yelling all the time, if you're miserable, if you're telling your husband to go F himself all the time, that's actually your soul saying to you, listen to me, I'm craving something and you're not letting me out.
Yeah, something's definitely out of alignment there, right? Yeah, yeah. Well, that is awesome. I mean, you know what? As you know, I'm a big fan. So thank you so much for being here with us. Now, if someone wants to learn more about what you do, where they can find you, I love that you're writing a book. So that's exciting. We will definitely get that out here. Yeah, and terrifying, of course. Where can people find you? I was just listening to you in my car on the loudspeaker while I was driving home from Hamilton earlier today. You're very accessible, and we can all be inspired by you. So where can we find you?
Were the girls in the car too?
Yes, but they had their wireless headphones on.
Good, because I was going to say, so I have my podcast.
You swear, girl,
I swear a lot. It's explicit. It's explicit. The podcast is explicit. It's got that little E next to it. It's Mom Is In Control. You can check me out online at my name, Heather Chauvin, Chauvin. Or I have so many free resources.
Let's tag a couple in the comments below on the Facebook page. I'll send me the links and I'll put them below.
For sure. But yeah, I'm anywhere at my name. And Jen, I just love you to pieces. Thank you. Thank you so much. I feel like a normal human being now that I'm able to have friends that do crazy things like me. So to
together,
create our tribe of mamas who think outside the box. So thank you.
Exactly. I love you. Thank you. You're an inspiration as always. We will see you again soon. And thank you, Fit Mamas, for being here today. See ya.
Wow, wow, wow. I have listened to that interview now a few times, and every single time I do, I get a few new nuggets of wisdom from Heather. Thank you so much, Heather, for sharing your story. Thank you for being with us here on the Fit Mama podcast for episode 32, and we can't wait to see you online some more. Thanks, Fit Mama. Have a great day. Namaste.